Let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our correspondent, Hani Espinosa.
Hey guys, here are news making headlines for Filipinos in North America. With just weeks to go before the November 5 election, Kamala Harris and Donald Trump are neck and neck in the polls. And in the final stretch, Trump is focusing on what has been the defining issue of his campaign, immigration.
And we will begin the largest deportation operation in the history of the United States. We will close the border. We will stop the invasion of illegals into our country. We will defend our territory. We will not be conquered. We will not be conquered.
From his rally in Colorado, California, and Arizona, Trump intensified his rhetoric on immigration.
This excites him, especially issues around the border. And when people who support Trump or people who are, you know, kind of Trump curious, you know, they see images of the border, they hear about what they consider, you know, the bedlam around the border, it riles them up. And this is why immigration is still one of his top issues that he keeps talking about over and over again.
According to a recent Pew Research Center survey, 81% of registered voters say the economy is their top issue. Among Trump supporters, immigration and violent crimes are the next two leading issues.
Meanwhile, two key battleground states are starting their early in voting this week, Georgia on Tuesday and North Carolina on Thursday. And in the Peach State, election officials are saying a new record has been set.
Georgia's Secretary of State Brad Raffensperger says as of 2 p.m. Tuesday, close to 188,000 votes had been cast in person, setting a new record for the first day of early in-person voting. The first day early voting record is 136,000 votes cast in 2020. With 8.2 million registered voters, Georgia is viewed as one of the critical states that could influence the final outcome of the presidential race.
I think this is an existential election. It's going to have implications for my children and my three grandsons and more to come. So it's critically important that everyone at least voices their vote.
Former President Donald Trump was scheduled to campaign in the state shortly after early voting began, with a rally at the Cobb Energy Performing Arts Center in Atlanta. Early voting will continue until November 1, with some counties offering additional voting on Saturdays and Sundays.
And finally, we head to Florida, where some Filipino Americans are showing that the Bayanihan spirit is alive and well in the aftermath of Hurricane Milton.
In the wake of the storm, some Philam organizations are stepping up to help.
I've been talking with my organization called Jack's Filipinos, and together with the resources of the consulate, we'll be putting together some type of a fundraising activity or donation activity together with the organizations here in Jacksonville to try to get more donations to go down south.
Members of the Bisayan Connection Incorporated provided evacuees with food and water.
We really take it seriously for our humanitarian kababayan or naibing kababayan in a community na makatulong, na magtatanong kami kung anong maitutulong ng BCI. So we're ready to support.
Some Philam Floridians are helping out in their individual capacities, like Scott Woodfelt, who opened his home as a shelter.
I have a few friends that are staying over because they're in a area that tends to flood or they might lose power. You definitely want to be able to take care of your neighbors.
And those are the news-making headlines today. You can catch more TFC News on the ABS-CBN News website and YouTube channel. I'm Hani Espinosa. Back to you guys at the Rundown.
The United States warning Israel it must take steps in the next month to improve the humanitarian situation in Gaza or face potential restrictions on U.S. military aid. The U.S. State Department confirms Secretary of State Antony Blinken and Defense Secretary Lloyd Austin have written a letter to Israel demanding concrete measures to address the worsening situation in the Palestinian enclave. The letters outline specific steps Israel must take within 30 days, including enabling a minimum of 350 trucks to enter Gaza per day, instituting pauses in fighting to allow aid delivery, and rescinding evacuation orders to Palestinian civilians when there is no operational need.
We didn't think it was appropriate to send a letter and just say this has to happen overnight. We give them make clear there's a short window in which we want to see changes because the humanitarian situation is so dire on the ground. But it is appropriate to give them some time to work through the different issues and find ways to get the level of trucks, get the level of food, water, medicine back up to acceptable levels.
The letter is the clearest ultimatum yet to Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu's government since the Gaza conflict began, raising the prospect of a shift in Washington support for Israel. Around 460 overseas Filipino workers have been repatriated from Lebanon since Hezbollah forces there have come under Israeli attack. Philippine Migrant Workers Secretary Hans Leo Kakdak says 256 others are set to come home via commercial flights until October 28th. Another 250 are awaiting clearance from Lebanese immigration. Kakdak says the Philippines will ramp up repatriation efforts should it upgrade its alert level for Lebanon.
And of course, it would be quicker to put a group of OFWs together and board them on a chartered flight, or as the president said, on a flight that would based on mobilized government resources and assets. So we stand ready to repatriate OFWs in the event of mandatory repatriation or alert level 4.
The leader of Canada's New Democratic Party calling for sanctions on Indian diplomats and a ban on a Hindu nationalist group. Relations between the two countries have been fraught since last year when Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau said he had evidence linking Indian agents to the assassination of a Sikh leader on Canadian soil. India and Canada have recently expelled each other's diplomats after Canadian police linked agents of the Indian government to broad criminal activity in the country.
The RCMP basically painted a picture that a foreign government is engaging criminal elements in Canada to perpetrate violence against Canadians, including shooting at homes, shooting at Canadians' homes, killing Canadians, shooting at Canadian businesses, shooting at Canadian communities. I don't want the Indian government or Modi to think they've got someone in Canada who's willing to look the other way to ignore what's going on. We need to take an approach where we're all on the same side, that we're all denouncing this serious series of allegations, and that we're standing united to do everything possible to protect Canadians.
India's main opposition Congress party now urging Prime Minister Narendra Modi's government to take all political parties into confidence regarding the worsening ties with Canada. India has denied Ottawa's accusations, describing them as part of Trudeau's political agenda. It's nearly Halloween, and that means in the U.S., it's time for the monster pumpkins to come out. At Half Moon Bay, California, the 51st annual Giant Pumpkin Weigh-Off concluded with a nail-biting finish, with the winner presenting a 2,471-pound gourd, edging his closest rival by a mere 6 pounds. His prize for the record-breaking pumpkin, $9 per pound, or a little over $22,000.
I mean, well over 20 feet around, so if you think about that, that's a pretty big pumpkin. It's basically 7 foot by 6.5 foot.
Ever seen them in person, and one after another, there are so many, I can't believe it.